What's up, guys? We're here at the Rtisan Podcast, and I have a very special guest, somebody who's been a mentor to me and to literally thousands of young people in and around Chicago for the better part of four decades now. I have the distinct honor of introducing to you guys Mr. William McClellan. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Supposed to do this Monday, but I ended up going out of town, and you know, you came through on a Friday for me.
It happens.
Yeah, it does. I had a good time, by the way. I should have told you that. But just so we can give people a little bit of understanding of who you are and where you're coming from, you've taught. Tell them a little bit about yourself. Let's do it like that.
As far as me as a teacher, I started in 1971, but I was in music from 1960. I was in the Giles Yellow Jackets Drum and Bugle Corps. Then I went on to Displays Vanguard Drum and Bugle Corps, marched in the Marine Drum and Bugle Corps, and did Northeastern Illinois University, Vandercook College of Music, and then started teaching, and I've been teaching bands at Finger High School. I have to think about them. There's been a few of them.
Yeah,
Finger High School. I did the orchestra at Chicago Vocational High School. I then did the band at Curie High School. Then I went from Curie to Collins High School. And from Collins, I did a two-year stint at Steinmetz. And then my last 10 years as a teacher, I was at Kenwood Academy, 8 years band director, 2 years assistant principal. And then the last 6 years of my career, I was the supervisor of music for the city of Chicago, Chicago Public Schools. You know.
So in short, he's probably the most well-qualified person to be talking about musical education, pretty much any and everything that has to do with the arts education in Chicago. And you're probably one of the most well-traveled teachers, as far as like your where you've taught, who you've worked with. Your resume is impeccable. You know, I mean, I'll say it for you. If you didn't gather that from that, and your experience working really at the highest levels, at the city level, so you got to see things as an administrator that you didn't get to see as a regular teacher.
Yes.
You know, and I'm sure you started to see what that really was as an assistant principal, and then it went to a whole another level once, you know, were you working with, not Mayor Daley, was it Mayor Daley, or were you, who was the mayor when you started working there?
In CPS?
Yes.
It was the Richard J.
Right.
The father.
Right, okay.
It was the father in 71.
And you were with his son when you left out?
Yes.
So, man, that's a long damn time.
Yeah, it is. 38 years.
Yeah, so you've seen everything.
I've seen a goodly amount of things.
Yeah.
Everything is, that's absolute. But
sure.
I've seen a goodly amount of things.
Absolutely. So, I really want to get you on here because, you know, I came up through CPS.
Yes.
Came up under you, you know, proud to say that.
Yes.
Spent a lot of time in the Ravinia Jazz Program, in the Gallery 37, and After School Matters, in the All City Program. It's called something else now, I believe. But went to the military, played in a band like you did. Now I finished my degree at Columbia College Chicago, which is where we're at. Thanks for having us again.
Thank you.
And I came back while I was finishing my degree, kind of volunteering at Simeon, at these other places, just going around. And one thing I'm seeing is I felt like I had a pretty good as far from an educational standpoint, from musically. And now I'm going to some CPS schools and I'm seeing a lot of things getting cut. A lot of things getting cut. And it's breaking my heart. As I was saying before we started rolling, the music programs, the various music programs that I was very fortunate to be a part of, saved my life. And I'm sure that there are a lot of others that will say the exact same thing. And I would like to get your broad perspective before we start to get into the micro. Your broad perspective on where CPS is now. And if you can, sort of how we got here.
I don't know whether or not you can talk in steps as far as where the system is.
Right.
The system has been having issues from even when I started.
Right.
But moving to a different perspective of what they have now, where it's become more, how shall I put it, less regimented. For example, you had to go from a teacher to department chair, mm-hmm. to assistant principal, to district superintendent, before you could even consider going down to central office.
Right.
By the time I got down to central office in 2005, they were hiring people with little or no CPS or teaching experience. I was the only one in the Office of Arts Education that had an actual teaching certificate.
Wow.
And that's because of the way things have changed. I think education has changed. Obviously, the advent of technology has become an integral part. But also what has also changed, too, is the requirements for the arts and requirements for music. When I first started, we had an entirely different kind of graduation requirement, where they have now added on 3 years of a math, 3 years of a science. When right. I was in high school, mm-hmm. and when I first started, it was a year of science, 2 years of math, 2 years of math, 1 year of science, so that you add up to that.
Right.
Well, that has totally changed now. And what has happened is that the amount of time available in the course of a day has lessened. Also, we had, when they lessened the PE requirement mm-hmm. from 4 years to 2 years, I can't remember the exact date, I'm thinking it's in the early 90s.
Right.
We had an opportunity to add on more classes in music that we wanted to do. Since then, they have reverted back to the four-year requirement.
Right.
So that takes away a lot. They've also added other requirements that did not exist when I was teaching. So there's a lot of changes that have come on. I don't think that they've added on so many things now that it doesn't really get to teach what I call the holistic child.
Right.
You know, to me, there are four domains, mm-hmm. and these are mine. They are not anybody's. It's right. not from a book. They're mine. The mental, the academic, spiritual, physical, mm-hmm. and emotional.
Right.
And those, I believe that those four domains have to be dealt with as we grow up, as we evolve as right. human beings.
Right.
And so I felt that in band, in music, being in music, or in the arts in any way, when you have a young child coming in and they find their niche,
right.
they're going to be there. I remember you being in the band room at Simeon as much as possible.
Absolutely.
I had students, I called them band rats because mm-hmm. I'm a band rat.
Absolutely.
Whenever the time came that I was in class, because he'd throw me out if I was in class, right. I'd be in the band room.
Yes.
That was my haven.
Right.
That was where I went. So when I left there, I felt good about whatever. I'd be angry, mm-hmm. and it was so funny because it's a universal, it's a kind of a situation where I remember going in mad and angry about something mm-hmm. and then leaving the band room laughing and doing right. what I need to do.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah, and it is a change of life. It is a place that you can go. And I feel that our students don't have that.
Right.
They have so many pressures put upon them on two-dimensional issues. And I mean two-dimensional, mm-hmm. and I'm just being very honest and frank about it because... A kid can come in, I'm going to be an aeronautical engineer,
right.
but you're afraid of heights. I'm going mm-hmm. to be a oceanographer or a botanical garden. I work in the gardens, but right. I have an allergy to grass,
right.
you know, or I can't swim. Mm-hmm. You know, things of that nature that you'll put in. But when you put down, I'm going to be in music, you go, I don't know now.
Right.
Because,
right.
you know, there's not a whole lot in music you can do when, mm-hmm. in fact, that is not the case. There are tremendous amounts of job and college opportunities. for those of us in music. Both of us were in the Marines. I must put that in.
Right.
And, we must do that.
Yeah.
And the opportunities in military music are tremendous.
I agree.
Are tremendous. Mm-hmm. And so you were in the band.
Yes.
I was in the Commandant's Own Drum and Bugle Corps. Mm-hmm. And I would see the Marine band every day. And these are guys and gals that would come in and would, that's where they played. And they played, many of them got their degrees, many of them, that's what their life.
Yes.
And there is a track, and the biggest misconception is that there are no college or occupational tracks in the arts, and that is the biggest misconception. Mm-hmm. And so, for me, I see CPS has bought on to that. They've diminished so many things. We've lost. We had the band contest, which is almost 100 years old.
Right.
That's in jeopardy. They're doing some things, but there are things that are happening that are weakening it. We lost the jazz festival.
I didn't know that anymore. Is too bad.
And so they replaced it with the Jazz Institute, and then it's an Ellington competition more so than it is a CPS, and that was a 20-year endeavor.
Right.
What happened there, I don't know.
Right.
But I do know that in the arts, it doesn't carry as important a role in the overall scheme of things as it used to.
Do you know what they do find to be important at this particular time?
Well, of course, the AP classes.
Sure.
And those are the top classes and resource oriented, technology, IT.
Yeah.
And those two things I think have come in and taken over. I mean, okay, the IT is fine.
Sure.
And I'm not knocking that.
Right.
I mean, we're doing this blog
absolutely
with IT, and
absolutely,
there's nobody in there, and it's automatic.
Right.
But I think that we again take away that holistic kind of situation,
yes,
where we take away, we're here to build the three dimensions of the human spirit.
Absolutely.
And certain things don't. What we play, how we play in band, everything that they want, we problem solve.
Right.
We sit and work together as a group, as a unit. All of the things that are set down, we do on a daily basis.
Absolutely.
We problem solve on it. You put that piece of music in front of you, and you sit back and say, I can either play it or I can't.
Right.
I have a note that I can't play. Mm-hmm. So there you got the problem solving. You're working together. You're working together for a common goal. Mm-hmm. You're doing what you need to do in order to make it happen. And then you feel like you have made an accomplishment
right.
on a daily basis. I used to stress that to my bands. I would say, and I'm not knocking anything, but we've always had to deal. And you being, of course, at Simeon, mm-hmm. understood that Simeon being a school which puts out stellar athletes.
Absolutely.
And it was difficult because you can only start five at a time.
Right.
On a basketball court. You can only play 11 mm-hmm. at a time on a football field.
That's
only
right.
nine on a baseball field. Mm-hmm. But if you want to put 100, you can put 100 students
absolutely
on a football field.
Yes, you can.
100 students on a concert stage. You can put 25 on the jazz stage. You can put a combos in, mm-hmm. 3, 4, 5. And so you can accommodate as many as 300 kids
right.
in that program and still have success and still feel good about it. But yet and still, if I'm not the football star, the basketball star, the star pitcher, the star hitter, and I'm not trying to knock that because
absolutely.
that's a part of
we
what
all
we
love
do.
Sports.
But I love sports.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, the Super Bowl, woo.
Yeah.
I thought everybody thought it was a little dull. It was a little bit, but I thought it was well played.
I did too.
Sometimes the blowouts are boring.
They can be. I remember watching the Buccaneers and the Raiders in 2002.
Right.
The Buccaneers blew them off. I was like, man, this is not interesting.
No,
anymore.
It's not.
Yeah.
You lose interest. And
absolutely.
Then all of a sudden, it's 3-3. And next thing you know, you said, okay, two plays determine
right.
that game.
Absolutely.
So anyway, we're not going to digress on
yeah,
sports.
Yeah.
We do start that
yeah,
digressing on sports.
Yeah.
We can do that forever.
Absolutely.
But we it's the success that we feel. Not many of us are going to go into music once we leave high school.
Sure. Not many of us are going to go into IT
right.
or sports.
Right. So we choose a different path. I see so many of my former students who are in different paths, but the one constant that they remember, and you can attest to this, do you remember when we went here with band? Do you remember when we did this with band? Oh, Miss McClellan, you were one mean SOB.
Right.
But we loved it. We loved it. And a former student at Fanger was saying, who else can wrap toilet paper around the tuba and we still love you? Right. And I did that because they sure. sounded horrible. And I said, you need to take care of yourself
right.
when you have an accident.
Right.
Right. For lack of a better word.
Absolutely. Anyway. Absolutely.
You know. And so it's a situation where people don't understand, okay, I'm not going to be good in everything, but I'm going to find that one thing that I do in the arts. I can't draw stick people, but I sing every day. I think of music every day. I haven't been in front of a band since I was at Niles West back in November, but I still constantly develop myself so when the time comes, I go into that.
Right.
And it's something that stays with us. My son, who was in band with me for 4 years, still remembers all the tunes that we played in band contests.
Absolutely.
You do too.
I can't forget them.
You know, you do too. Mm-hmm. So it's something that was an integral part of the development of the human spirit, of the holistic individual. Mm-hmm. And if we take that away for something like, it costs too much money. Yeah, it does. It costs $250,000.
Yeah.
Well, that's a whole lot of money. Yeah, but it's better to spend that $250,000 developing a core group than spending $250,000 incarcerating our students.
Right.
Our kids.
Right.
Making sure that you have specialty things that they do. And some kids still play.
Oh, absolutely.
Some kids still
I'm
play.
I'm on stage with a lot of those guys, man.
Yeah. Yeah, and I see them all the time, and it's very important, and unfortunately, the Chicago Public Schools has kind of pulled back.
Sure.
And I'm not happy with that.
Right.
I'm not happy with that. The charter schools have come in and taken many of our brighter students.
Right.
But the charter schools don't have the offerings that we have.
Right.
In my opinion.
Right.
You know, so it's kind of sad. I offer my services to assist, but again, when people leave, you want to do what you do, and but I know I can still help.
Absolutely.
I know I can still help. So, and the jobs that I'm occupying right now,
right,
I'm doing that based on pure experience.
Absolutely.
You know, so it's just the development of the human spirit to me.
Sure.
And that's what it does. You remember band. You don't remember this teacher and that teacher. Mm-hmm. You remember those special times in band. I remember every second in band, and I graduated from high school in 1966.
Right.
And I still remember those those wonderful experiences that we would sit in the practice room and talk about each other.
Right.
And then the band director would say, this is not a place where you talk, you have to play. And it's so funny because I used to do the same thing when I was a director. They would come in and start talking about you, and I said, excuse me, I haven't heard one piece of music. You all are talking about this. You're talking about Japanese anime. You're talking about this town, you know, things of that nature.
Of course.
And I said, where's the band? Where's the music? And you don't play well enough. And one day I started laughing and couldn't stop because I said, man, that's you.
Yeah.
That's you.
Mm-hmm.
And you never forget it. You never forget it until your dying day.
Right.
You know, you bring up, what do you remember most, man?
I can't tell you how many of my friends I talk to, and they say, man, I wish I still played. Or I'm playing somewhere, and some guy in his 70s, some lady in her 60s, comes up to me. Oh, in high school, I played clarinet.
There you go.
Their eyes light up. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
You can see it. The minute they start speaking to you, and they tell you about, like you say, the pieces that they used to play, and I never wanted to do it then, you know, but now I wish I still played. You know, I know I'm not going to be a professional, but I just remember those times.
Exactly.
And, exactly. You know, I get calls now to do a lot of community orchestra stuff, you know, all over the place. I was up in Evanston. We talked about Evanston a little earlier. I was up in Evanston playing with an Evanston community, whatever it was. And everybody in there had to be over 60. Yeah. Most of the band was over 60. And there's former teachers there, former just hobbyists, whatever. And it was so good to see people in their advanced ages still really enjoying music. Because you could tell how stimulating it was for them. And their family was coming out. And it was nice to see people come out and support their family still. You know, because like you say, I love the words you use, the holistic building of people. Because that is 100% necessary.
Yes.
And I do believe that if you're going to force people to go to school and test them academically on, you know, math and sciences, these are the things that we also need to develop. Because, I mean, we all have that one song that we used to listen to when we were younger, and we would put it on repeat because it made us feel better.
Exactly.
Well, most likely there are musicians on that song. Mm-hmm. And those guys probably got their start just like I did, just like you did, in elementary band or in high school band, or maybe they picked it up for the first time in college, and they put the work in, and now, you know, you get 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 guys together, and then they can go and make something like that. And it feeds your soul, man. It really does. I mean, it happens to me every day. I listen to music from 200 years ago, and I still get the same feeling. It doesn't matter what it is. I can put on a song that was made 2 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, yeah, man, this is what I need. This is what I want right now. And I, you know, I'm gonna talk about this later in a different podcast. But you know, there are so many things I can't listen to now because I've been exposed to better. And I gotta thank CPS, but I give CPS a lot of crap for a lot of different things. But I gotta thank them because I was exposed to better. I was exposed to a higher level of music. Maybe that's not the right way to say it. But damn it, that's how I feel. That's how I feel. You know, I was given great instruction by people like you, people like Larry Pope, people like Mr. Crane, Mr. Coulter, Diane Ellis, all these, I mean, legends on the South Side, really. And that, you know, the North Side has their people, and the West Side, every district has their people that are just known for certain things. But because of that, in other areas of my life, it allowed me to grow. It allowed me to not really allow other things in my life to not dip below a certain level. And just certain things not here now on the radio, I just can't listen to it. And I'm thankful because that stuff doesn't seep into my spirit because I have had better, because I know better. You know, it's just like when you get used to a certain level of eating, you don't go back to certain things, you know. You just, your tastes are refined. I mean, if you broke, you broke. You can only have what you have. But, you know, I'm sure there are a lot of people that feel this way. And I don't know that these conversations are being had. I mean, you would know better than I do, but I don't know if these conversations are absolutely being had at the highest levels. But if they're not, you know, parents can see it. They see it when their kids are practicing at home and things. And, you know, what role do you think that parents play in keeping the arts alive?
My God, parents are the very foundation.
Mm-hmm.
And the unfortunate thing is that so many of our parents that I experience in my career really took that attitude of it's just music.
Sure.
And it's not going to carry you anywhere. It's not going to do anything. It's not so much that it's just music. It's that your child is in something. I bring my parents back. My parents, my dad was a mailman. My mom was a teacher. And even though both of them were college, my dad was a college grad, but, you know, coming up from Tennessee, sometimes right. It wasn't as easy.
Sure.
In the 30s and the 40s. But they never missed a performance that my brother and I went right. in. And especially when I declared music, and I broke the mold away a little bit. My brother was scheduled to be the doctor,
mm-hmm.
as my father's
right.
father was, my grandfather on my father's side
right.
was a doctor.
Right.
And I was to be a lawyer.
Mm.
And I was, had every intention going to college, of going to law school, and this thing called music, which started like 6 years before when I went, and it just stuck with me. And
right.
when my band director said 30 or 40 years of your life, and that was, 1967, which is what is that, 52 years now. Mm-hmm. And I've never looked back. Parents must support their children in all things that they want to do. You just can't give a kid a horn mm-hmm. and say, here, you do that.
Right.
You have to understand that this is something, and they're going to sound horrible.
100%. 100%.
I told parents, I said, please, they are going to sound horrible when they mm-hmm. first start. Support them, because this is a college scholarship track.
Right.
This is a occupational track. Mm-hmm. From that horn, you can move off into so many areas. It's a multi-tentacle profession that we are in, not just performance.
Right.
There's the performance is the tip of the iceberg. You know, there's so many things that go on that you can learn from that. And the parents have to support them. You look back and you go, and I'll say it, most of our black parents need to jump up and support. I understand that there might be physical things, but I see you must have support. Parents must support their kids. They must understand that the horn that you are buying will save you money in the future. It might cost you $1,000, $500, but it will save you at least $12,000 to $20,000 in college costs. It will save you money and I hate to say it, bail money. Mm. It'll save you from having to do that, because if you're in band rehearsal, you don't have time to rob, you don't have time to gangbang, because if it's done right, you are so tired, and then you have, I call them, your wonderful, crazy band directors who change their entire persona when a note is not right.
Right.
They are so nice, and all of a sudden, here comes, I call them Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, you'll sit back and you say, hey, man, that's really good. And then all of a sudden, the face will come around when a bad note goes, why? Mm-hmm. And the language I'm using is so much nicer than
absolutely
the reality.
It is. Absolutely,
of what
it is.
Right. It starts there, and then you start, and then you involve yourself in the parent organizations. Come back and support these kids. These kids, they'll end up saying, you don't want to go, Mama. You don't want to go. You don't want to go. Yes, they do. Yes, you do. You want to see somebody in that audience. I will never forget. My mother passed away in February, and she was at my last concert in 1998. Mama died in February of 99, and she was at the concert. She was at the concert, and she just sat there and was enjoying herself so much. She never missed with my dad. She never missed a concert that I was in. She never missed. Mm-hmm. And that means a lot for a kid. Oh, yeah, it kind of impedes you. All right, let's go home. Oh, well, I'm going out with the guys and the gals.
Right.
You know? But parents, you must support your children. That starts at the beginning. You support your children. Don't give them no dollar bill and say, come home. You come to the concert.
Right.
You make up the band. You come to the awards banquet. You make a big deal out of what they do.
Right.
And it's going to come back to you. And this gentleman here is perfect example.
Absolutely.
Right here.
Perfect 100%. Example. 100%. I'm going to take a quick break, and we're going to bring it right back around, because I really want to get in on that and talk about my mom and how she became the quintessential band mom a little bit, and how you can do the same thing for your kids.
It is ridiculous.
And now with the new thing,
I got a car repair this year, man. Say anything. Get him up here now.
But man, talk about mom, please. Mom is so. Woo.
Yeah, man. I thank her every day, man. Every day.
And don't forget, you made the district band with ILA.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Remember, you made the district. I believe it was Joe Manfredo. Happy with that band, but that's okay.
Yeah.
We're back.
All right, guys, welcome back to the Rtisan Podcast. I have Mr. William McClellan, the esteemed CPS teacher and just musician. We left off talking about parents' roles in the children's education. And just to illustrate this point, you were talking about your mom. You know, I'm going to talk about my mom a little bit. And, you know, my mom has not missed, especially in elementary and high school, did not miss a single concert.
I remember.
And I, you know, I used to tell her, you don't have to come. You don't have to come. Don't worry about it. You know, I don't know if it was because I was trying to get out from up underneath her shadow. Maybe I felt like I was becoming my own man. Whatever it was. But man, looking back on it, it was invaluable having somebody there to play for specifically that came to see me. Somebody that was nurturing me at home and who also took the time to nurture me outside the home by putting me with some men who knew how to help shape a young boy, you know? And sometimes, you know, I don't want to make this about single parents thing. I don't want to make it about that. But sometimes you need to hear certain things from men. And sometimes you need to hear certain things from women that that aren't your mom or your dad. Exactly. And sometimes it hurts. Damn it. You know, it is what it is. But the fact that she knew that and she trusted you guys to give me the things that I needed musically, and her knowing in turn that would allow me to build a foundation for myself. I was fortunate enough to be able to do the Bands of America camp. I don't know if you ever knew about that, but in 2006, I did. It was the summer of 2006. So one of the ladies there was on the board for that camp. And that it wasn't a cheap camp. We went down to ISU.
Familiar with that.
Yeah. And you stayed there the whole week. Exactly. And they brought in top flight clinicians, top flight performers every night. So, but there's no way I would have been able to afford that. She heard me playing at the jazz band competition. And she was like, yo, I don't know who this young man is, but we got to get him down there. And she did something, and I was able to go to that camp for free. That something like that only happens when you have the support of your parents to make all those funky sounds on the trombone that I was making. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Yes. All those funky farting sounds and, you know, really continue to encourage me to continue to get better. We talk about the district band. Made the district band back-to-back years, which was a big deal for me. It just so happened to be the exact same years that Derrick Rose and the Simeon Wolverines won state championships. Mm-hmm. And they got the whole front page of the website. I got one little line. Exactly. You know what I mean?
Right.
It was okay because I was right next to him. I felt like I was doing something special. But that was only possible because my mom, every Saturday morning, picking up my cousins and my sister, dragging me down on all city band every Saturday. Going to Jones, going to Saucedo at the elementary level. Mm-hmm. Coming up into Columbia because we were doing it. Columbia was Saucedo. Right, yeah, for
right,
a few years.
Right.
What building were we at back in the day? All of that. All those things just multiplied themselves, man. You know, I'm sure you had a few superstar parents. The Zakiya Powell's mom and dad. I still talk to her. I know she was very involved. They were very involved for her and Jabari's success.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to be totally honest, all the most successful kids that I remember in band, or pretty much anywhere else in life, their parents were heavily involved in the things that they were doing.
Exactly. It's not, you can't do it by yourself.
No, who can?
You can't do it by yourself. There's no way you can do it by yourself. I bring up Marquise Hill, who is just all over the world.
Oh my
his
God.
His mom was just, from the time she walked into Kenwood, was just an integral part of his development.
Right.
And through his time at Northern. And so if you don't, as parents, if you're going to get your kids into anything, you got to be there. If it's music, dance, judo, art, whatever you're going to get into, make sure that you support them. You don't have to push them to be number one.
Right.
But you just have to make sure that they are doing what they're supposed to do. And if they decide not to like it, don't.
Right.
I'll give a perfect example. My late son, William Jr., we wanted him to play baseball. He had as much talent for baseball as a worm trying to move a mountain.
Right.
And I say that, and I love you, Billy.
Right.
So I would take him over and work with him trying to get the ball. His hand-eye coordination didn't work.
Sure.
He played T-ball. And I remember one time he sat at the park, and I picked him up, and he said, did you play in the game? Mm-mm. He said, well, what happened? I don't have my glove. Where is it? That's one. I knew then that he wasn't going to do it.
Sure.
Well, this kid at 11 decided he was going to learn tap dance, and he's tap dancing on the table at LaSalle Language Academy.
Right.
So he graduated from Whitney Young as the top dancer, and he graduated from University of Illinois as the top dancer. He was major choreographer and one of the lead dancers for Dayton Contemporary Dance.
Right.
And went to University of Michigan, got his degree in dance choreography.
Right.
All that to say is because we saw and supported what he did.
Right.
We supported what he did, even in college. That drive down to Urbana is not easy, then having to drive down and drive back, but it was because he was in that. And I attribute some of his success to a very small degree to his mother and I, who did some sacrifice.
Right, absolutely.
And it's going to be sacrificed, but that's why you have children.
Right.
Put them in the arts. Get them in the arts. What they find they don't like or can't do and not good do well at it, and they don't like it, they don't feel good about it, get them to do something else, but support them and do what they needed to do.
Absolutely.
And you see, and you will see the results. Maybe you might not, they might not be the greatest musician, may not be the greatest artist, dancer, you know, maybe not be the greatest actor or spoken word artist, but they will be, from that experience, better people and stronger human beings. It's very important, very important.
Absolutely. I'm 100% with you on that. I did not know your son was a dancer. That is interesting.
Absolutely.
That is fantastic. I'm sure he was wonderful. Before I let you go, and I know you got somewhere you got to be soon, what message can you give young people who want to become educators? I mean, you can talk about it as a band director, but just educators in general. Because band directors are educators, through and through.
Without
question. They may not be teaching math, but damn it, I challenge anybody to teach 6-8 to somebody that can barely count to 4. You know, that's a music joke, but if you are in music, you know what I'm what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking
that's
about.
Very true.
Man, it's and to get 50 people to do it at one time, it's a whole other thing. But what words of encouragement, what advice do you have for anybody who's looking to become an educator or a band director?
First of all, it's a thankless job. Don't expect a whole lot of money. You're going to be paid well, but you won't be rich and wealthy. You're going to be paid well. You're not going to get the thanks until 10, 12 years later. Here's Jeremy right here. We'll let you know that when you're there, I hate him. I can't stand him. But after that, you'll see him, and they'll realize what you do for him. Do it because you love. You love it, whatever this discipline that you want to be in. And don't be afraid that you won't make it. Teaching is difficult, but you have to have it within yourself to be want to share. The one thing that you can't be, if you're going to be a successful educator, you must not be selfish. You must be willing to give what you have and what you know, and then work on more things that you want to know. It's every year you're going to get better. So don't fall back on what I did last year, because what I did last year might not work this year. Don't be afraid to be a teacher. Don't be afraid to sit back and bring your students. Love your students, love your job, love what you do, and you're going to be fine. It's all centered around that love and the confidence that you have within yourself to give of yourself, because that's very difficult to do.
Absolutely. One last thing. Any message for your former students?
Any message? Y'all just say hi to me. Say
y'all
hey.
Y'all better speak to this man.
Say hey.
Yeah.
Every once in a while I come up to you on Facebook. Hey, what's happening?
Right.
You see me on the street. Say hi, Mr. McClellan. So sometimes I might not remember you, and I will equate, and the first thing I'll ask you is what school.
Mm.
So don't get mad that I don't remember you by name. You know, because some of us change, and you know, right. Some of you at the beginning of my career knew me with hair and a beard. Now you see, I don't have any.
Right.
But just communicate, stay with it. If you can get back on your horn, do it. But just be yourself and say, "Hey, you see me on the street, Mr. McClellan, hi."
Right.
And I'll have deer eyes and say, "What school?"
Right.
So don't get mad.
Right. Well, guys, I want to thank you all for joining me today. This was a very special podcast for me because, like I said before, this man represents something in my life and as well as several other people's lives. And it's not just him as an individual. It's what he represents. One, a father figure. Two, an educator. And three, just somebody to look up to and aspire to be just as a general success story. So allow me to say thank you to you, not just as a young black man talking to an older black man, but as a person who came up through CPS. I can't say thank you to all my teachers because I don't know where they are. And most people can't. You know, we just, life takes us in very different directions. But from one student to teacher, thank you for all that you do. Thank you for all the sacrifices. My God, thank you for the sacrifices that you have made and that you guys have made, because I would not be here if it wasn't for the kindness of others. And I appreciate everything that you do, and I appreciate the decision, the selfless decision you made to take young knucklehead little boys and turn them into men, man. So I appreciate that. I really do appreciate that.
One thing, Wendell Phillips, class of June 1966. Go Wildcats.
There it is. Thanks, guys. We appreciate you a lot.
Bye now. Thank you.
Man. Dude. That was awesome, man. That was awesome, man. You the man.
Don't get me started. You the man. I